Bonjour, je suis Frédéric Migayrou, directeur adjoint, je suis en charge de la création industrielle et donc nous organisons avec Ircam
incompletude in the field of mathematics. That is a kind of transformation of the idea of continuity. And Follenmann, who supported his thesis very early, I mean, during the war, I mean, had to go to the United States and migrate and flee. He fled to the United States at that time due to the communist government at that time. But anyway, I mean, he went to the United States. It was simulated, and it was part of the research team reflecting upon the atomic bomb and the blow of the atomic bomb and how we could transform the, and study this in a mathematical way. And Stanislas Willem and someone else, I mean, Richard Feynman also, I mean, together they're going to try and find what the kind of modeling system they could develop that is a kind of a formalization of a stochastic field, which is the field of atomization of particles. And the idea of cellular automates was going to be applied to the computational field with a big computer, Lignac. And this computer allowed at that time, it was a big, very big machine, allowed to develop this work on cellular automates. And then will be applied by von Neumann. And that's where it's very interesting, because this is going to be applied in biology, in weather forecast simulation, but also in the economic field on a stochastic study. And also, this will appear on the stock exchange platform. But this appeared in 40 to 43, but in 45, 46, and this field of research appeared around von Neumann. And there's also something very interesting regarding computational aspect. This is a platform which appeared in London with the acquisition of a computer of the new generation after Lignac et Diac. There was a new computer which was implemented in the United States also, IBM working also on digital platform. And this computer is going to be set up in this Cambridge school and the impetus of an architect, Leslie Martin, and who's going to develop this software platform, which will be available to various architects, and we'll find a new architect who will, in the 90s, are going to work around the computational world. Some people, like March, is going to develop work after the United States, and they will work on simulation and cell automates. And we're going to discover people who are going to try and understand in a different way this formalization work through the idea of language. So the idea of language, which is dominating, because we are living in a structuralist period, a period of Tintin. I mean, all this work on cell and distribution of cells, working on language and the formulation of architectural language. And so at that time in Cambridge, I mean, there will be people like Christopher Alexander who will invent the pattern language, this idea of patterns, the repeating patterns. Peter Eisenman also, and you may imagine that the thesis, Eisenman thesis, was competing with Christopher Alexander. Took inspiration in this linguistic formalization, which is directly oriented towards Chomsky, and thinking about the linguistic computational idea. And then he will go through the English school, Czech grammar with various scientists. I'm not going into a keynote lecture, but still, I mean, a number of architects, I mean, are going to work on Czech grammar. And we can see this notion in Peter Eisenman's work with the idea of typology and architectural morphology, with another itinerary developing also the Italian view, also with a kind of linguistic reading of architectural formalization, because we're talking about architectural formalization. Now, from this stage, English stage, we'll see Colin Raw, which is from the Renaissance, and he was the commissioner of the Five Architect event, cooperating with Eisenman, with the reading of the five, with the five American teams working on the language of architecture. And this is fundamental. It's very important to understand this pre-structuralism which exists in the United States, hence the this Italian school and acceptance of Italian schools by Peter Eisenman, going back to the Italian Renaissance architecture and the formalization during the rationalist period with Etelani, until the notion of architectural formalization with the first houses. In London, there will also be a new trend, which is the cybernetics with Gordon Basque, and also someone who is very important for the architects in the 90s, John Fraser, who is also part of this Cambridge school. Now, it is very interesting to understand the contemporary stage, the platform, to understand this linguistic structuralism, and on the other side, I mean, understanding a kind of pre-morphological aspect of architecture linked to cellular automation. And so this is very important to understand the contemporary platform. So adding to this, the last person at Cambridge at that time is William Mitchell. William Mitchell is going to animate the MIT with Ponti. And so we have all the players of the computational architecture without going through Cambridge. But with this structuralist view of computational formalization of speciality and spatial aspect. So the idea is to go to the end of formalization, that is, move from geometry to algebra. And that's where, I mean, the itineraries are different, because when I speak about a non-standardized architecture, I go back to the algebraization, trying to explain what morphological structuralism is. That is, not working with numbers, but rather with infinite numbers. Now, instead of having one, then we have 9, 9 point blah, 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 which is a kind of infinite number. So in the long run, then we come into the complexity theory. And the main disciple, French disciple, Abraham Robinson, George Reeb was René Thom's professor. You know that he was inventor of the catastrophe theory, the theory of catastrophe, with modelization and modeling with the seven catastrophes, building up its understanding of the continuity or discontinuity of space. And René Thom, then a new trend will develop with Jean Petitot, Salansky, etc. But I won't go further with another idea of construction of meaning. Different from traditional structuralism, that is, we have this linguistic structuralism towards morphological structuralism. So 12 teams of architects developed and working all with softwares which are sort of modelers or pre-modelers like Katia, Premaya, sort of shape describer softwares. With Renault, but Renault was not used in a general way. Now, the exhibition and the non-standard concept using a different kind of algebraization. And thinking about all this, I mean, I called Philippe Morel, who is here in the audience. And then we thought that we would work on a new idea, a new way of understanding algebra. And so he went to the Institut Poincaré, because I was very much interested in Poincaré model with traditional algorithms and algebra. And then he met some mathematicians who said that there was a new software, and this new software was called Mathematica. So you have to understand that Mathematica is working with cellular automation. The first software which goes beyond the geometry to work with cellular automation. And so these cellular automation within software is a complete revolution, because the scenography, the non-standard scenography, will take place with Mathematica and not with more academic and architectural software. And here again, it's kind of disruption, and that's where we go into different directions. With the most innovative architects now working mainly with this cellular automation, with this kind of discretization system, a total automation of the matter, whatever the scale, and the same software. These digital tools are being applied at the moment in nanotechnology, in biotechnologies, in physics, also in quantum physics, but also in economic analysis, in weather forecasts, et cetera, et cetera. These are the same tools being used. There's a consistency which developed between these various fields. Another event which is very important is the will to ignore a kind of trend which set up in the 90s, that is the Santa Fe school of trend. I mean, we wanted to disregard this. I mean, we are reaching the artificial life, 15th symposium with Stuart Kaufman, very important regarding the foundation of Santa Fe School, but someone also is very important, Christopher Langton, who will develop the work on simulation, since it generalized the simulation from the cellular automation until Melanie Mitchell, also, who will publish a book which is called Non-Standard Computation. So the Santa Fe School will join this stochastic thought, actually, in the mid-80s, which are now being applied in all the disciplines, because the school in Santa Fe developed helped scientists all around the world. So it's very important to understand what's going on in the various disciplines in our work for mutation creation. It was very important to have the historical background to see what's going to happen in terms of research and creation, and to measure the consequences of this algebraization of the whole world, which is not anymore dealing with geometry, but rather understanding a kind of code, and the code will be the topic of the next edition of this event. For architects being invited here in this session, then we may say that I know them very well. For most of them, Philippe Morel, because in 2003, I mean, we worked together on this cellular automation with Automatica, and now we're moving on to XtreeE with 3D printing. 3D printing is something secondary, I mean, casual, I mean, in the sense that it's very important in terms of industry, but it's not in 3D printing itself that we find the epistemic and radical rupture of the computational field. Of course, it is kind of the cellular automation is being applied. Philippe Morel, Denis Sabin, of course, who works in the same way on organic matters. This idea of distributive matter is going to work with one of insulation in Archilab, but also PS1, working on a more and more complex environment with the same tools. Emmanuel in the discrete lab, maybe the youngest one, developing the same work, but still applying a constructive policies, innovative systems. Joris Laarman also, I don't know when he was asked for the, when we ordered his first piece, because he's very young with a new piece today. And it's very important that a designer, in the meaning of the real meaning of the term, in terms of design, but is with us today, I mean, doesn't think anymore in terms of object, artifacts, but rather in terms of condition, production conditions, the shaping of matter, the relationship between organic and physical matter, that he thinks different, and then thinking later of an industrial production. Laarman is an innovative fabric with using copper and carbon also. But here, I mean, we are facing a generation which is covering an epistemologic field going through the various disciplines. So that's it. That was for a short introduction. Now I would like to give the floor to Gilles Emmanuel. I've known Gilles Emmanuel for quite a while. I mean, he was invited to various events, and he teaches at the Art School of Architecture. We founded two labs, two different classes, and for the first time, we're going to develop software with engineering and in connection with a design platform. Thank you.
Both work, right? Thanks, Frédéric, for the introduction.
Merci, Frédéric, pour cette introduction. Merci également donc, à Marianne, Olivier et tous les autres pour avoir donc organisé cette très belle exposition.
It's a pleasure to be here. And, we do a little bit of the work that we've been developing in the research lab for the last 3-4 years. So as a brief introduction, yes, we run a research lab at the Bartlett School of Architecture together with Molly Claypole and Vicente Soler. And we are also running two graduate programs in architectural design and architectural computation at the Bartlett School of Architecture. So our research lab looks into robotics and large scale 3D printing. And we develop computational design methods that allow scaling up processes applicable to an architectural scale. So we always have been implemented it with chairs. Maybe we're in a new stage now from this year. But essentially, these are processes that could be scaled up to an architectural object. So basically, it is the same syntax that gets applied to a small representation of the object. But this same syntax has the ability to scale up as a design method.
So what we'll be showing today is mainly our work with robotic spatial printing, which is one of the agendas that we're pursuing in the school. And we'll try to basically advance an argument for something that we call discrete design and production using those projects. And in a way, the kind of research started really when we came to the Bartlett as extremely young, fresh graduates and were confronted basically with the mission, you have to do something with the robots that are in the school. And our first reaction was essentially to look at the wide proliferation of robots. They're today almost in all architecture school in the world. But we were noticing that actually the kind of paradigm that is underlying these robots, that is very much a monolithic paradigm that has a few core assumptions that we would like to question. And it's very nice to have Greg Lynn in the audience because we're using his diagram to explain basically that idea of continuity. So the idea that people were actually thinking about robots as devices to materialize continuous architecture. So to essentially look at continuous forms, ideas of topology, and using the robot as a device for mass customization. So essentially, the robot is used as a mechanical device that allows you to realize topological forms by basically segmenting it into series of pieces that are all completely different. And that kind of paradigm is almost assumed universally across all these different research institutions and schools. That's also combined in a way with an idea of the architect then as a kind of architect maker or architect craftsman. And it's very much disconnected from larger ideas of, for example, syntax or how you would actually think more about scaling up. So it's very much this kind of, let's say, kind of small scale culture of the digital craftsman. And so we were really interested in going through the notion of the part, through the notion of the discrete, turning this notion of continuity upside down. So rather than defining topological form and then slicing it into a series of segments, we wanted to start very much with the idea of the part in the first place. And that then is what we call that discrete paradigm for design and production. And this comes partially from work by Neil Gershenfeld at MIT, who suggested this idea of what he calls digital materials. So he actually says if you want to do digital fabrication, if you want to engage with digital fabrication, you have to first of all operate on materials that are digital. And a material that is digital, it's a very simple idea. It just means that it has a limited connection possibility, 0, 1, or a few more options. And essentially the projects that we've seen before, so the projects that are based on mass customization, never have a part that can be considered as a digital entity. They're essentially analog operations. And so what you see here is really a series of experiments where we're trying to define very simple digital building blocks, in this case, series of toolpads that act as digital pieces and then start to aggregate and start to compute very much in line with what Frédéric was describing in his introduction, that very much start to compute the larger halls. So for example, in the case of 3D printing, and which refers very much to the exhibition upstairs, the idea is really that we don't first compute a form and then slice it into elements, but we start basically from a very simple toolpad, just with two points, which is in a way the zero and one, the entry and the exit of a line, and then we aggregate those lines. We let these lines compute a larger form. So essentially, the kind of that idea of continuity is really, we really see then a curve that that very much consists of an aggregation of parts. And so this was in a way kind of the start of our teaching and research at the Bartlett, was this kind of provocation to say, okay, actually all the use of digital manufacturing machines around the world, they're all used as analog machines. And they're basically used as machines that continuously add or remove material. And in a way, then this is the confrontation, asking what is the difference now if you operate not on a digital material, but you operate on an analog material, are we not just automating artisanal actions? And where is then the difference basically the image on the right and the image on the left? And again, the same provocation, it's not because you use a robot or you use a 3D printer that essentially you're challenging the design paradigm, because we're just automating analog actions. And that's something that's very much accepted in, if you talk, for example, about CAD-CAM, I think all the architects or the whole discourse would agree that if you just draw in AutoCAD, you're just replicating an analog action. But we haven't accepted that in terms of fabrication. So that discourse hasn't really reached fabrication. And of course, this is also, it's a little bit a difficult argument to make, because of course, the automation of analog human actions has a huge impact on the world. That's how our industry works. And that's also what is disrupting today the market of labor, et cetera. But we really took this in a way also as a kind of a challenge to basically start to think, could we actually discover an architecture then that is not analog in terms of material and fabrication, but it's actually fundamentally digital, right? So that's then the other provocation, basically the statement, like, look, after all these years of digital research, we actually have never been digital, which is kind of a play on Bruno Latour and also what Frédéric mentioned today, kind of play on Colin Rowe and Eisenstein's exercise, where they state that we have never really been modern, and actually modernism is a kind of a continuation of classicism, right? So we're interested to find out if there would be a possibility of thinking about an architecture that is in its material organization fully digital, and also in its conception and in its mode of production.
Yeah, so regardless the appearance of a continuity, of a continuous surface conforming an object, this is actually described as multiple pieces serialized, completely identical, that are actually arranged to conform in a specific shape. So our work for the last few years have been testing out this idea of discreteness mainly into different paradigms. One is actually playing with the piece itself and fabricating with an assemblage of those pieces. And another one that is the image on the right and is the piece that we are currently exhibiting upstairs is actually playing with the same piece that is containing an information that eventually will make an entire whole. So all the curves that you see in the image on the right are connected to make a continuous toolpath. So as you can see in these images, this is actually a cloud of points of data. It's instances of the same piece of data that are arranged together to conform a whole. So we are gonna specifically base our presentation in a technique that we've been using for the last few years, which is air printing. One of the first examples was ETH in grammatical color research, but they are using space printing as a way of making it much more efficient. So you are actually making a more efficient use of the material by triangulating it. However, the technique is still layering an object, so the object pre-exists to the actual conception of the toolpath itself. So there's a two-step process. You first create an object, then you slice it, and then you create the toolpath to fabricate it.
So this aggregations of toolpaths then in a way, establish a kind of a counter paradigm in a way to that idea of continuity. So this is kind of the continuous curve broken down in a kind of a volume of lines without any notions of topology, geometry, or actually even without notions of space. So it's just essentially a cloud of data with pieces, with toolpath fragments that in a way start to assemble. And that's the thing that we in a way call digital syntax. It's independent also, we can also imagine that this would be other building elements and not only toolpaths. And so what you see then also by reintroducing the idea of the part is that you can also start to conceptually think about multiple scales. So basically we can start to relate the smallest scale of a toolpath fragment to the very large scale of the building element itself, or of a discrete building element. And so what we'll do now, this was a little bit more of the background, we'll run you briefly through these three projects, which have been done over the past 3 years, and explain a little bit more the computational system behind this work, and then also talk a bit about the consequences of this discrete turn.
So the first project we want to show is called Cure Voxels, and it's basically implementing this idea of a point of data, right? That in this case is a voxel, a three-dimensional pixel, right? That is containing identical information. So there is a plethora of these voxels that are rotating with 24 different rotations for connecting into a continuous curve. So you see, for organizing this data, there you go. So to organize this data, we're using, in this case, a structure analysis. So basically, the areas where you need more material density, a higher material density, these voxels subdivide to become smaller and smaller, and therefore conform denser lines. However, this is all connected into a continuous line that goes from a layer by layer or a denser deposition to an deposition that is more three-dimensional and therefore weaker as well. So we tested this in three different objects based on a Panton chair. So the important piece here is not the bounding box itself. We're testing it in a Panton chair, since it's a complete different utilization of the same material that was used for the original Panton, but trying to optimize the material distribution with different subdivisions. So you can see here the different densities achieved in the object, where it requires a higher density, then these voxels divide until they become just points and connect into continuous lines. Yes, you can sit in the chair. That's important to mention.
And then again, it's just this idea. And if you look at the section of the object, that you again understand that there is no notion of topology, no notion of geometry, and no notion of kind of continuity that that is describing the chair. Of course, it's printed in the end in a kind of ironic way. It's printed in one single pore with the robot in one single line, but it basically consists of a cloud of simple discrete elements, which are always the same ones, and they always have the same connection possibility. So in a way, it's completely turning that kind of idea of mass customization upside down and making an argument that heterogeneity really emerges from serial repetition, from the kind of a weird version of the assembly line. And so the next project is a kind of continuation of the project Manuel just described. But rather than putting one single curve in the voxel, now we're actually using the voxel as a more complex device for computation. And it's basically embedded with a kind of polyhedral object. And then the printing direction basically runs through that object and then starts to recombine the edges of this polygonal object, which gives us much more possibilities of varying the curve and working with different densities. And then what is also important here is, in a way, that argument about the scalability or these multiple hierarchies of the syntax. So by using exactly the same logic of the recombination of the toolpaths, so that simple logic of a single line, we're then also able to extrapolate this to a larger object, which then introduces, in a way, that idea of physical discreteness. So whereas before we were printing objects always as one whole, in this case we're essentially printing larger building blocks, which again have a digital connection logic and can then be assembled into larger structures. So it kind of interrupts that idea of kind of suggesting that idea that we're not looking at 3D printing an entire building, but we're basically 3D printing building blocks, and then these building blocks have the same connection logic as the actual tool pads that construct a building block and then get assembled into a larger whole.
So in a sense, we're engineering the material within the bounding box that becomes a piece that could be repeated, connected and reconnected. And to have a bigger or a larger variability in this, and to have a more holistic approach to it, we decided to develop a software where you could designers could actually implement different pieces of toolpaths, and they could organize the material in different ways, always responding to constraints such as printability. So we created a company in Avila, Spain, which is a very small city back there. And we started developing these prototypes and together with the development of the software that you can see here. So this is the first version where you can extract structural data. You can also play with the data itself. You can vary the object, the density of the object, the scale of the voxels. You can basically create your own material organization within the object. So the bounding box is not, let's say, the important object to print anymore, but it's actually the fragment of toolpath that you can compute into different objects. Yeah. So as you can see here, in this case, it's again a Panton chair. So we're dividing this Panton chair into different voxels that intelligently that reorganize and rotate to create this continuous line. This piece is a 2.46 kilometer long continuous line that can be printed in one go with the robot. It's also choosing into four different kind of pieces to achieve larger variability of the object itself, the material in the object, and it can go from really dense areas to really porous areas. So we created 39 prototypes, and we printed one for this exhibition, as you can see upstairs. So this is the printed object. It's the first versions of many others, not essentially chairs, but any objects that could actually deal with these principles. So now we are also working on a scale-up version of these prototypes, but maintaining the same material organization. So this is a way as well to serialize errors in the production of the object. So computing only one particle, one line, being always the same, you can actually essentially make sure that line is printable correctly, and therefore repeat the same operation along the object.
Then to in a way, the last projects will show are in a way trying to come back a bit to that idea of what makes an object analog or digital, because of course the argument we confronted with in the beginning, the argument that an object should be maybe also physically digital, is not the case in the case of these 3D printed chairs, which are obviously one object. So we started alongside the research agenda into 3D printing. We started to also look at a research agenda into additive assembly. So essentially, it means you assemble objects, but you follow exactly the same procedure as when you would be printing an object. So instead of continuously extruding material, you are continuously assembling building blocks. So we're going to compare now another Panton chair, which essentially, instead of a 3D printed voxel, makes use of a physical voxel. Is this playing? Yeah. Which makes use of a physical voxel. And it's again always the same voxel. It's a serialized piece. It appears on two different scales. And then these elements can basically be combined with the robot into this chair objects, and it follows the same layered assembly method. And then this also has a really big implication for representation and to the way how we relate to the object that we're designing, because essentially, if you follow this workflow, you're essentially breaking the gap between design and fabrication. Because normally, also in the case of these 3D printed chairs, you essentially first design the object and then send it over for fabrication. But in the case of this digital assembly or this additive assembly, the design can take place at the very same moment of the fabrication. So at the very same moment that we're fabricating the object, we can still make decisions about the sequence of assembly, we can change the object, and we can also intervene anyway as authors and collaborate with the robot on removing pieces. And we've implemented this through all of the pieces you see are trackable with a camera system, so the robot in a way knows where the pieces are, it has a consciousness about which structure it's assembling, and it can then make a series of decisions. And that radically changed, in a way, the relation that we have between the design process and the fabrication process, because they happen at the same time. And to give you a little bit of an insight into how those decisions are made, so some of these decisions are made based on a primitive understanding of structures. We're basically looking at how these pieces are interlocking or combining, and then trying to make a series of next decisions to see whether we can reinforce the object or whether the object is too weak or not. So what you see here on the screen is, in a way, this kind of structural analysis process taking place, and then a whole army of mutant chairs that comes out of this software. And this gives you a little bit an idea of how the computer or the robot understands this. So this was a small experiment where we're looking into physical space. So we have that's the vision that the robot has of the building blocks, and then it can make a series of decisions in real time where to add building blocks. And then as a human being, you can kind of come in the process and intervene there. So maybe to wrap this up, we would kind of argue that that the beginning of this work is pointing in the direction of a digital syntax. So it's a way to work with architecture beyond notions of geometry, surface, and topology, purely with algorithmic operations of symbol serialized building blocks. And I think we'll keep it there. Maybe just some credit. So the chair you see upstairs is printed with Nagami design, printed in Avila. And these are just our websites. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Just one question for me, and we can give the opportunity to the people to ask you direct question about your processes. What is interesting for me is the idea of the distributive materiality and the fact that you can change the scale and to have density or more open distributive materiality in other space. What does it mean in terms of continuity? Is it a way only to develop your work with 3D printing? Is there for you other possibilities from this concept, the distributive materiality, to work with other technical processes?
This is essentially lining up a design method, which is not necessarily related to 3D printing. In fact, some of our other research within the lab are investigating other areas and other materials. I think what is important is that you can actually control the density in a given a cloud of points. Those points could be materialized as fragments of toolpaths, right? And they could be actually continually printed with a robot, as we described. But there is essentially no difference between that process and the syntax that some of the digital assembly process are inheriting. In fact, the point distribution, that point could get any form of shape, right? So in some of the cases of the projects that we've been showing, the curve is inside a voxel, right? But actually that voxel doesn't even need to have that proportion. So some of the pieces that we're trying to play with, they are just embedding design aspects within the piece itself to basically define how the pieces could be connected with each other to actually create different densities and different material organizations.
And it's also, I think it's also important to mention that it's independent of scale as well. So, of course, the object in the exhibition has a very high resolution. It's very detailed. But in a way, if you maintain the digital syntax or the design method in a way, then we could also experiment with much larger objects that maybe have a much lower resolution, but maybe are more applicable immediately today. So I think it's a kind of an agenda we are pushing with two different speeds, like maybe in some scale, in a very simple material, in concrete or something today, we could apply these methods immediately. And then maybe on a longer term, it's more an agenda of looking into these extreme possibilities of robots.
Est-ce que quelqu'un veut poser une question?
Would somebody like to ask a question?
No. Bon. Sorry? Après les questions, bon, très bien. Okay.
I think we have the opportunity to ask questions so later. So, thank you very much.
Jenny Sabine, donc on est content de l'accueillir parce qu'elle vient d'inaugurer son nouveau laboratoire à Cornell University.
She's presenting here now the kind of bricks, kind of distribution system, which you can see in the exhibition, and she's probably at the top of research regarding the idea of cellular, but also the relation between biotech and material creation and artifacts as well. And so we find this relationship with craftsmanship in her work.
Thank you, Frédéric, for the kind introduction. Good afternoon. Thank you to Marie-Ange and Frédéric and Olivier for the opportunity to exhibit work in this incredible exhibition. So this afternoon I will address the subject of my research and work through the lens of my transdisciplinary collaborations with an interest in developing an alternative material practice in architecture through the generative fabrication of the nonlinearities of form across disciplinary boundaries. So I'm going to start by talking a bit about the foundation for the work, and then I'll talk about two research topics and three projects within those research tracks. So this video compilation, just go back here. Highlights a series of data sets produced in some of my collaborators' labs, as well as visualizations and simulations that we've produced over the years. I collaborate with a number of scientists, cell biologists, material scientists, mechanical and electrical engineers, bioengineers, and many others. And to be sure, biology and material science present very useful conceptual models for us to consider as architects, where form is in constant adaptation with environmental events and cues. It's here that geometry and matter operate together as an integrated elastic ground, what I call a datascape, where geometry, matter, pattern, materiality, form, and contextual events are inextricably linked. And it's through direct references to the flexibility and sensitivity of the human body that I'm interested in developing adaptive materials and environments where architecture, code, pattern, environmental cues, geometry, and matter operate together as a conceptual design space. It's the embedding of material systems with biological relationships and behavior to generate models that are at once natural and also artificial. It starts with very simple rules and parts that through feedback and iteration produce much more complex spatial wholes. Importantly, it also engages the productive tinkering or misuse of digital fabrication machines found in alternate industries that are informed with issues of craft and making to produce bio-inspired material systems and software design tools that have the capacity to facilitate embedded expressions in our built environments. Similar to Detlef Merten's description of what he calls bioconstructivisms, the emphasis here is upon the analogic negotiation of morphological behavior as a dynamic template that is then filtered through material organizations to produce models that, as I mentioned, are at once natural and also artificial. So the emphasis here is upon behavior and processes, and we purposefully resist the post-rationalization of complex form through an approach that engages materially directed generative design processes, or what we call matter design computation. So one of the fundamental questions that we ask is, how might buildings behave more like organisms responding to and adapting to environmental cues? In the not-so-distant future, materials will not just be elements and things in buildings. They will generate immersive spaces, acting upon and responding to affordances within our built environments. Like the cells in our bodies, sensors and imagers will learn and adapt, making materials not only smart, but also aware, sensate, and beautiful. So I frequently find myself in spaces that one may not think that architects frequent, although I think I'm in good company in this crowd. This was a photograph taken on the first day of a course that I taught for 4 years with a longtime collaborator, Dr. Peter Lloyd-Jones. And the title of the course was Nonlinear Systems Biology and Design. And I taught this at Penn before taking my position at Cornell. And we paired graduate architecture students with postdocs and fellows in the context of the lab setting. And in the very beginning of the collaboration, Peter and I spent about a year just learning how to communicate. He would engage in my studio reviews. I would engage in his weekly lab meetings. And we quickly realized that although we shared many like terms, we had very different definitions for those terms. We had radically different structures in place for how we conduct research, how we publish, how we garner funds, how we teach. And it took quite a while to just figure out how to collaborate effectively, because collaboration across disciplines is messy and it's not easy. And when I look back over the years, this was now over a decade ago, I think that investment of time was incredibly important. So Peter presented to me the extracellular matrix as code. He is a trained matrix biologist. And the big idea here is that half the secret to life resides outside of the cell. So you have DNA or code within the cell itself, but that code is acted upon by environmental cues and contexts within a protein-rich extracellular matrix environment. So this presents a series of very powerful ecological models to consider, a dynamic biological reciprocity, feedback enmeshed in the production of morphology and form. One could say that the cell is like a loom, 3D printing and laying down its own extracellular matrix, which it then communicates through in real time. So I found this to be an incredibly powerful space for thinking about behavior, thinking about processes. Another longtime collaborator of mine, Dr. Xu Yang, she's a material scientist. We continue to collaborate formally through federal funding agencies such as the National Science Foundation. She engages biomimicry in the true definition of the word. She looks at the feet of gecko and the leaves of lotus plants to produce superhydrophilic or superhydrophobic materials, water absorptive or water repellent materials. And we've invested a lot of time on the topic of structural color. So looking at dynamic switching of color and transparency through wavelength dependent films and materials where we design and synthesize at the nano level. So in this case, color change is not pigment based, it's entirely how we perceive light and the way that it reflects and refracts. So it's about geometry and structure. A recent collaborator, we have been working on projects together for about 2 or 3 years now, specifically looking at kirigami, which has come forth through a second NSF grant. And kirigami is like origami, but with the addition of cuts and holes. And Dan is a bioengineer doing amazing work with 3D printing of hydrogels and integrating synthetic human DNA to program that matter. And so we're working together to design and program these materials to actuate as a part of their own material makeup, so reducing the amount of energy that's input into the system. So when I started all of this work in 2004, when I was still at Penn, both Peter and I did not set any strict goals, and that was quite purposeful. We had a shared commitment in the co-production of a truly collaborative space. And we thought at the very least we might generate some new questions, and at best we would begin to generate new applications, both in biomedicine and also in architecture. And over the years, that has been more formalized, and a series of phases has emerged. Typically, when I start a research project or an applied project, we develop tools. I like to think of scripts and code as a new type of material, so developing tools to model behavior. Some of those tools are brought into the realm of architectural prototyping, so productively contaminating the process with the stuff of making, and meaningfully and responsibly dealing with the problem of scale. And some of those successful prototypes are then brought into the realm of building and issues of building ecology. So it's a purposefully slow process. So I'm going to talk about three projects under two topics. The first engages adaptive structures and form, and the question, can generative fabrication give agency to material? In 2009, we were fortunate to procure a grant to purchase our first 3D printer. And I purchased a large powder-based printer, which is still in use in my lab today. And at the time, it featured the largest build bed. And I was interested in working with a 3D printer, not for representational means, but for the rapid manufacturing of parts and components. Peter and I were very interested in the prospect of what it would mean like to hold data, to look at it in alternate scales. And so using the facility of the 3D printer to work with non-standard components to model behavioral processes that we were finding in the biological models presented to me on the part of Peter's lab, and then bringing them into the context of 3D printing. Some of the things that we were looking at. This is a data set that was produced in Peter's lab of a multicellular structure, an acinized structure of the human mammary gland. So you can see with the confocal stains, the nuclei stained in blue, and the exterior basement membrane or extracellular matrix stained in green. And we were looking at both healthy and disease scenarios. These are the same cells undergoing tumorogenesis. And in the context of Peter's work, he was looking at how subtle changes in the architecture of the extracellular matrix could in turn change the architecture of these multicellular structures undergoing tumorogenesis, hence diseased, back into a healthy scenario, which that in and of itself just blew me away, that you don't attack the cell, you actually look at the environment that that cell resides within. So we began to develop parametric models and visualizations of those data. Visualization and simulation actually became our immediate bridge and point of departure. I was actually quite blown away by what wasn't going on in the context of the lab, and so we were able to lend immediately our facility with modeling behavior and generating tools to produce simulations of these data. And I think more importantly, a way of thinking in design that was systemic and relational. And so we were developing a whole series of prototypes looking at surface design and the deep tissue of that surface design. That surface is only skin deep, so to speak, and looking at the internal dynamic processes that were underlying that, albeit in an analogic way. And it was during the summer of 2009 when we were pushing forward with some of these prototypes that I began to think, well, you know, couldn't we put a different powder-based material into the printer? And in addition to my graduate work in architecture and all of the years that I've now been working in architecture, I have a BFA in ceramics, and I thought I had left all that knowledge far behind. But I realized that it was actually quite useful, and it was something that was very much of my body. And so what you see here are our first successful 3D printed greenware, high fire stoneware parts. I produced our own recipe in-house, a mix of a dry clay body, a little bit of sugar, and maltodextrin. And we swapped out the proprietary glue with a vodka water-based solution. And so we, on an economical end, went from buckets of proprietary media that costs about $600 US to about $2 US dollars. And so what you see here is the same part, 3D printed in the regular media, and then in our recipe, bisque fired, so chemically changed to ceramic, and then glaze fired and infiltrated. And what has emerged from that early investigation is a series of formal research trajectories, including a course that I've now taught a number of times and now has been transformed into a studio exploring digital ceramics. And on view in the exhibition is three iterations of one of our current research tracks, just simply questioning the brick and its dimensions. And with the possibility of 3D printing, we can look at systems where every single brick is unique, but has a coherent strategy for how they come together and assemble. So this is iteration 1.0, where we were really just working out the technical issues with a very simple waffle grid and looking at the topics of porosity and lightness and how we might begin to steer those more effectively. So I'll show a video that we put together that highlights all three phases. This is in the exhibition, but the audio is not featured. So I'll go ahead and play this to give you an overview.
The production of ceramic blocks and tiles has a long technological and design history. Ceramic modules of standard measurement have been used as building block in replacement of stone for many centuries. Ceramic bricks and tiles, so ubiquitous in their application in the built environment, have surprisingly lacked recognition as a viable building component in contemporary architectural practice until now. Polybrick, our latest endeavor, the topic of digital ceramics in the Sabin Design Lab at Cornell University, showcases next steps in the integration of complex phenomena. This work includes advances in digital technology, 3D printing, advanced geometry, and material practices in arts, crafts, and design disciplines. The first phase of the Polybrick series features the use of algorithmic design techniques for the digital fabrication and production non-standard ceramic brick components for the mortarless assembly and installation of the first fully 3D printed and fired ceramic brick componentry. Polybrick 2.0 is generated with the rules, principles, and behavior of human bone formation. This allows for the production of variegated bricks that are light and porous at the top of the wall, dense at the base to carry load and maintain efficient structural integrity, while also amplifying material and formal expressions. Polybrick 3.0 takes our material investigations to the next level. Synthetically designed with advanced bioengineering, these biobricks will exemplify the cutting edge future of biologically steered clay and ceramic building blocks in architecture. The two prototypes utilize 3D printed clay, hydrogel, and synthetic DNA. As you can see here, a unique ID stamped with DNA in the form of a C for Cornell is fluorescing within the polybrick and clay body. Brick stamping has a long history where variegated size, shape, and stamping indicate place, date of construction, and type, and thus serve as invaluable historical documents. With our unique DNA stamps and glaze, we explore the possibility of live signatures and dynamic surface techniques coupled with non-standard bricks in the context of living matter and digital ceramics.
So that last iteration is current work that I'm doing with Dan Lau and his lab, working with clay as a medium of life and synthetic human DNA as a dynamic surface glaze application. So we're really excited about where that's going. I thought I would share one project. Some of you are familiar with it, Frédéric and Marie-Ange, of course. This is Polymorph, which was on view as part of the 9th Archaeolab at the Froc in Orléans, which the exhibition was titled Naturalizing Architecture. And with this body of work, I was very interested in synthesizing what at that point was about 8 years of investigation into cellular networking processes and their morphology, primarily with the work of Peter and others, not as a direct reference to a particular data set, but as a biosynthesis of a way of thinking about the production of form from a single cell, its connection to a neighboring cell, to multiple cells, to a confluent sheet or surface, which further bifurcates and networks into larger organs and morphologies. And so that led to a whole series of simulations and generative investigations, just questioning the materialization and formalization of a node, what that might be. And again, with an interest in working with very simple parts as input. And so Polymorph, which is a spatial structure now permanently housed at the Froc in Orléans, is composed of three components, which are digitally produced and individually hand-cast, that have over 250 different ways of interweaving. And so the material system features two surfaces that interweave together and a very simple background organization based on an equilateral triangle and an isosceles triangle. And that was very important in terms of optimizing the connections across each of the units. So this was an early rendering looking at the possibility of some of those spatial prototypes and their topology. In this project, I didn't directly print the components, but used the 3D printer to optimize for slipcast design. And if you know anything about ceramic slipcasting, it's very difficult to produce simple two-part molds if you have complex curvature and undercuts. And so we were able to generate a series of algorithms to optimize for that, 3D print positive halves of those molds, and then produce about 20 plaster molds per each of the three components for slip casting. Now, the structure of Polymorph required that it be slip cast because running internal to all of these components is a continuous network of stainless steel cable that's in tension, thus pulling all of the ceramic componentry into compression. There's about 1,500 individual parts. They all safely arrived to the Froc. We didn't sleep for a few weeks until they did. And this is how we worked. We pre-tensioned swaths and then connected those swaths to each other. And as you can see in this image, it's slowly starting to take shape. So it's a rigid spatial prototype. And again, everything inside a stainless steel network in continuous tension. This is where it's housed in the new edition by Jacob and McFarlane. And you can see here in situ as the sort of lacy, calcified, woven network begins to emerge during the installation. I'll probably never do a project like this ever again. It's incredibly complex, although simple in its inputs. And it's not a sphere. There's three different inversions, as you can see in some of these holes. And it changes quite a lot throughout the day with the change of light. And so I'll close with the second topic, which is moving from the exploration of non-standard components and issues of generative fabrication and specifically working with 3D printing. I could have also talked about adaptive materials, but for the sake of time, I won't. But this explores adaptive environments and specifically looking at knitting processes in textiles. One could say that knitting is the first example of 3D printing, additively layering link by link, row by row material. And I've been working with textile-based processes, specifically knitting, since 2012. I received a commission from Nike to produce a pavilion as a part of their Flyknit collective. They invited six artists and designers and architects around the world to basically riff on key benefits that they were seeing coming forth from a technology that they had been working on for about 10 years, which is the Flyknit shoe, and that is probably familiar to everyone at this point. And they were genuinely interested in how we might bring these benefits, performance, form-fitting, sustainability, lightness, back into our own fields. And so I presented to them, I said, well, I want to work with knitting. And they were surprised by that, and I was surprised that they were surprised by that. And so I was interested in working with the simplicity of knitting processes, their generative nature, and the complexity of the human body as a series of bio data streams. And then thirdly, striking up a collaboration with Shima Siki, which was quite important. They're at the forefront of what they call whole garment knitting. So seamlessly 3D knitting digital forms. And so I was interested in really pushing the boundaries with them. They work at the scale of the body, typically in haute couture. You can probably imagine who they work for and work with. But the possibility of working with seamless 3D forms as a point of departure was quite exciting. And so we really pushed the scale, and these are some images of the MyThread Pavilion. I'm not going to talk specifically about this project, but it was my first exploration into the invention of a new material system that integrates solar active, high-tech responsive fibers and photoluminescent high-tech responsive fibers. And so the solar active change color immediately in the presence of UV or the sun, and the photoluminescent absorb UV energy and slowly glow. So at a micron scale, the photons are being agitated, and when the source leaves, they slowly emit light. And most recently, I had an opportunity to do a number of projects for Nike, and most recently I produced a pavilion for the Cooper Hewitt as a part of their beauty exhibition, which was their fifth triennial. And in this project, I was very interested in really pushing forward the rigors of all of the R&D and the previous projects in terms of how we were going to control and optimize the flow of force, tension forces, through the knit assembly. Again, as a kind of dynamic reciprocity, hearkening back to the beginning of my talk, understanding the relationships between the production of form and environmental input, thinking about force as an actual design parameter that one could work with in a dynamic way. And so I did a whole series of investigations and analysis with Arup, actually, on this project, working with minimal surfaces and the production of minimal surfaces through cellular units or components. And this project, I took on another hurdle, which was to move away from tensioning the knit structure to basically a frame, to thinking about a reciprocal system where the act of bending structure, which forms the knot at the edge of these inflections, how that would hold up the knit structure, and the knit structure would hold up the act of bending armature. And the second leap was to look at a double surface scenario where there was an inner surface and an outer surface, which I think in many ways references back to years of investigation with Peter and Shu and others into surface design of cells and their active connections. Again, as an analog and looking at a synthesis of that thinking in design. And here you can see that installed. So getting the tension just right on this was pretty labor intensive and difficult. The finishing process for these projects is, we start out with very sophisticated digital investigations, but I think you can see in all of the work a theme of moving back and forth between fast-paced digital computing and fabrication to very slow analog production that is very much about the human body, at least at the prototypical phase. And so all of the finishing and sewing and production of the final fabric structure is for the most part done by hand. I am innovating that with a new company in Philadelphia where we're starting to automate some of the pre-tensioning of the net structure, which you can see in this detail. And this is now going to be on view. The name of the project is Polythread, at a new design museum that's opening in China this coming fall. And so I thought I'd close with a final video. As Frédéric mentioned, I was fortunate to win PS1, the MoMA PS1 YAP competition this year, and so we're incredibly busy right now. And this is taking the work specifically in the textile investigations to an environmental immersive landscape within the courtyard matrix at PS1 in New York City. It opens June 27th, so if you have an opportunity to see it this summer, please come by. We produced a complete immersive VR experience, which at the presentations with the curators, I think, went over really well. And in the proposal, I was very interested in putting together a project that would be highly transformative throughout the day. So one's experience during the day would be very different from that to which you would have at night, providing both public and sort of private intimate moments within these groves of stalactite knitted conical forms that have a network of misting stations. The brief calls for water, issues of sustainability and recycling, and that we would deal with warm-up, which is their weekly party where they invite DJs from all over the world. And so the misting network will be based on a proximity network of sensors. So as you approach these conical stalactite forms, they'll slowly start to mist and glow. Inherent to the material nature of the work is an investigation into some of the shifts that we're seeing away from Cartesian formal orders of column, beam, and arch, to, on a meta level, more feminine forms of interiorities, matrices, networks, and social fabrics. The seeding component are composed of recycled spools, making reference to the textile-based nature of the project, robotically wound to tension them. We deconstruct them and CNC the caps to form cogs, which are then robotically wound with a microcord that's photoluminescent. It's big. I'm a little nervous about all the knitting, but we'll get there. So this will be the second project, much larger in scale, where I'm taking these responsive fiber-based high-tech materials into the environment, which I'm really excited about. So they will actually be reacting to the sun, the presence or absence of the sun. And then there's a sort of little cheeky play on hidden messages. The spools will be printed with their own letter with a hydrochromic ink that's activated with the presence of water. So this is just a summary of our work. Here's our websites if you'd like to check out more of what we're up to, both in the studio practice and also my lab that's based at Cornell. I certainly don't work alone. I work with a number of collaborators, students, research, postdocs, and so on. And we've been fortunate to receive quite a bit of funding to do this work. So thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Jenny. Of course, it's absolutely fascinating that your work from cells could be transferred at any scale with any material, from biotech to real construction. I like particularly the work with the knitting and the idea of the first punch card in the 18th century, the métier à tisser, you know, and is really revealing of the quality of your research. I would like to know what could be possible at a real architectural scale. I'm dreaming about the bricks. What
what kind of combinational system you could dream about to transfer your work. It's obvious, of course, in the installation PS1, but we thought about real architecture now.
Right. With the bricks specifically?
Any others? I don't know.
Yeah.
The material. You work with all materials. Craft is really in your hands, mm-hmm. In your mind. All the processes of architecture are there, composition, combination, and so on. We're close to something which could be built in the city.
Yeah, definitely. Well, one project that you are familiar with that I didn't show is the Eastkin project. And I would say, and that resides within sort of topic of adaptive materials, although all of these could be in that topic. I think that project is probably at the most mature level in terms of a viable industry product. And this is a thin film technology that we've innovated, which at the start, the cell was our muse to understand how their manipulations of a specific organic polymer, and in turn our manipulations of that polymer, would affect the behavior of the cell. And we weren't proposing to put human cells on buildings by any means, that wouldn't work. But they were our muse, and so at a particular scale, we were able to extract that fine scale design ecology, that dynamic reciprocity, to then redesign, engineer sensors and imagers that would be locally dumb, but would respond and learn over time. And so we're now looking to work with perhaps Kodak. They actually have some incredible things going on with thin film technology. And our vision is to begin to look at how it can be applied in either existing facade construction or a new facade design. The polybricks, the current work I'm doing with Dan, although we've gone back down in scale, I think what we're innovating at a material level with DNA steering with clay is really exciting. We have some time to go in terms of it then scaling back up into bricks. But the polybricks, I'm excited about the promise of, you know, why not have 30 powder-based printers on a construction site? And, you know, thinking about more of a networked scenario of brick making. So we'll see.
We can dream about what it could be. Okay, thank you. Next one is yours. Joris Laarman est sûrement le designer un des designers les plus avancés
probably one of the most famous 3D. Designers in 3D printing.
Avec la bonne chair, avec
working first of all with bone chairs, which means in fact synthetic material and then copper. And he's also been experiencing this bridge in Amsterdam that we built in 3D metal printing.
Certainement une rupture
and
dans la
this would be the first 3D printed bridge.
Ici, c'est un designer I think this avec would be totally different.
So this is a designer with an extraordinary quality of design.
And
this is also research work that is quite interesting. So this idea of this concept of design that is adapted to usage, to human usage as well as beauty.
Thank you. I have no idea what you just said, but I think it's fine. yeah, first of all, I'm afraid I will bring down the level of intellectual language. Because I'm not quite a scholar, I'm. You should consider us as a group of thinkers that is highly linked to a world of upcoming technology. We have a group of about, I think, 40 people now in Amsterdam working in a workshop, building cool stuff with technology. I wanted to show this as a first image. It's a graph that I'm working on. It starts with the beginning of time, the Big Bang. It should be interactive in a couple of months. That shows progress, and the amount of time the light gray area is the area in which I've had my practice. Anyway, it's for me. I look at it often to see in what kind of context I'm working and what's actually happening in the world. And we like to surf certain waves of innovation that are going to be important for the upcoming future. And I think the next 25 years will be extremely scary and extremely exciting at the same time. Let's see. I'd like to start with the bone furniture series that I've created in 2006. It's a project that started already in 2004. It was the beginning of my fascination with the digital world taking over the physical world, basically. This is Klaus Matek. I followed his work. He's a very peculiar personality, but did some really fundamental research on topology optimization and the growth of bones and trees. He makes really funny books about a bear called Pauli and explaining about topology optimization to kids. Some people from his research group went to work at Opel, a car manufacturer that's now owned by, or was owned by General Motors. I think it's now bought by a French, like Peugeot, I think. They created an algorithm that mimicked this natural growth of bones and the way they optimize themselves. That's the image what you see on the right. You see a car part and it and how it optimizes itself without losing strength. And later on, a smart way of how you would be able to cast it as well. To me, the animation is not really like just an animation of a car part optimizing itself. When I saw that back in 2004 or something, it was really an illustration of how we go from the industrial era into the digital era. And it's a very nice visualization. You see the object that starts as an object that is about geometric form that could be made with industrial machines, optimizing itself into something totally organic that is actually only possible to make with digital fabrication tools. And on the left, you see the inside of a bird's bone as an illustration of how bone looks like from the inside. I approached these people to, if I could use the algorithm to actually design something, so not just optimize an existing part, but to actually generate form that would make sense. So here you see a chair with a specific load case that we apply to the surfaces, seat surface and the backrest, and how the structure optimizes itself into this form that I could have never sort of invented myself. So this was not an example of a designer making some sketch that was later on transformed into something that could be produced industrially. But it was something totally unexpected that came out of it. So after that, we researched several ways of how we could produce something like that. And the first prototype we made was done with LOM technique. It's one of the, I don't know if it's exactly the first type of 3D printing, but it's a very early version of a digital fabrication tool that basically puts layers of paper on top of each other with a layer of glue. And after the block is done, you take away all these little blocks and your beautiful looking object comes out. Unfortunately, the technique didn't result in something functional, so you're always you always have a weak link in your layers, so it becomes highly fragile. I looked into different ways of producing the chair again, and we found a company, a very tiny aluminium casting company in the Netherlands, who was willing to help us out, and we developed a type of 3D printed ceramic in which you could cast an aluminium part in one piece. So the ceramic part is assembled in a that's what how you see it on the left. That's basically in the thing in which we cast the mold. Later on, it is all broken away. So unfortunately, the mold is lost. But then you have your aluminium complex part in one piece. First, it's quite important that the things that we make are functional, so that it is useful. I am not really linked to a university, so we kind of rely on selling these objects to actual people that use them. And therefore, the materiality is very important to us. So a lot of the research that we do go into the material qualities. We created six different objects that illustrate this this process. This was an exploration in doing something like that with a soft material that is not entirely soft, but it's like a rubber Shore 90 in a different asymmetrical shape. We've created our own compound later on that allowed us to cast complex forms into 3D printed molds. This is an armchair and a rocker that is of which the mold is assemblable with little nuts and bolts, resulting in these objects. A table. In the end, we came to a collection of about six different pieces that is now called Bone Furniture Series. And every object in the series is done in a different material and needed a different way of thinking, basically. This is a project called Maker Chairs. I have kind of a love and hate relationship with 3D printing. I think it's great, and I think everybody sees a lot of opportunity and that it's really going to make a huge difference for future production. At the same time, if you are critical and look at what it is right now and what you can actually do with it in functional terms, it is very limited. We saw the price of these consumer printers going down really radically at a certain point in time, but you couldn't really make something useful with that with these small machines because of their limited bounding box. So we created furniture pieces that were cut up in puzzle parts. So with these small affordable machines, you could make pretty complex objects of a fairly large scale that were all built up out of puzzle parts. We created a website for this called bitsandparts.org, and you can download these designs for free. And I think in 1 year we had already had like 10,000 downloads, and we got all these really cool videos in from people all around the world creating these chairs. We've had some quite a lot of discussion with IKEA about doing something on a really large scale, but unfortunately they were still a bit too scared of 3D printing. We also invented the new hipster term crowd fabricating for this. So you could actually, with your neighbors, create a chair if you like. And especially the kids' version is very popular. So, of course, it takes much less time to make. And it's a lot of fun to actually make it with your kids. We also do a lot of furniture pieces done in not in 3D printing, but in digital fabrication in general, so CNC milling in wood, and various designs and patterns. Pretty complex to make as well. So another project that really dives into the materiality of in digital fabrication and the combination of that is the microstructure series. This was basically an investigation in dividing furniture pieces up into multiple cells that are smart in some way. So on the right, you see half of a chair that is filled up with flexible cells, as well as constructive cells, as well as cells that create the most lightweight structure. And on the left, it's an image that shows specific stress lines that go through the object. And this evolved into a series of multiple objects in various materials, starting with the soft gradient chair. Around that time, we saw 3D printing in thermoplastic polyurethane coming up. Thermoplastic polyurethane is a rubber type of material that is soft. So in this chair, you see a construction flowing through the object in 3D. And where the cells are more dense and closed, they become structural. And where the cells are more open, they become more lightweight and soft and flexible. So you could basically, it is like a digital foam, if you like. So you can basically, on a cellular level, dictate where you want specific areas of the chair to have a certain functionality. We eventually dyed the chair as a dark blue color. This is what it eventually looked like. So in the backrest, you see that cross, for instance, that's where the structural area is. Another object in this series is in an aluminium chair. Aluminium is, of course, has a long history in in design as a lightweight, somehow futuristic-looking material. We created a fairly simple algorithm that generates a gradient from solid to open. And some nice aspects of this is that you can look straight through the object from three perspectives. It generates a pretty interesting looking object, in my opinion. I think most of you have seen these type of films about powder bed 3D printing. We worked together with a company from Belgium. It's a tiny company that was willing to change their machine. It usually was used to print titanium parts for like bone implants and such, to transform it into a aluminium printer. And we are creating a lot of different types of products at the moment with the 3D printing of aluminium. Our studio is pretty hands-on, actually. So I consider it to be a bit like a mini society, where we have people that do coding and generating algorithms, work together with people that are really like craft people that know a lot about materials, wood and metals and stuff. And they actually learn from each other a lot. And that's really something I like. So it's not just the smart computer people that dictate what the other people should do, but it's also the other way around. And these are visuals of the chair. Here you see how the gradient goes from this solid part where you don't want to have all these tiny structures because they will easily break, transforming into something that is open and lightweight. Next chair is called Adaptation Chair in the same series. This was a research into dividing the chair up into long cells that would morph into different geometry according to the height of the chair, evolving into a seat surface. This chair is also on view at the exhibition in the building here. Our work is a lot about functional ornament. Even from the beginning, when I didn't even work with computers, and this chair is a lot about that as well. This piece was printed. This piece was actually printed as a polyamide object at first, and then was electroplated with copper. Eventually, the copper makes the chair strong, and the polyamide is actually not functional anymore after the copper is applied. This is a project that was really inspired by research done on universities around the US that was about self-assembling materials. Our first idea was to actually create an object that could self-assemble itself, but because we always aim to make actually functional things, it was a bit too far off. But nevertheless, this research is like super exciting and inspiring, I think. The promise basically is that you have a basic amount of material to which you can upload a design, and the design assembles itself into the amount of material assembles itself into a design. And if you're fed up with the design again, you just upload a new design and it reassembles itself into that different design. Well, looking at the research, I sort of thought it was in such an early stage that you could somehow compare it to the evolution of 2D digital design, like in this case Mario, where it starts as a really stylized, pixelized little Mario into something that becomes much more realistic later on. So we created this robotic installation for the High Museum in Atlanta, where a robot would assemble this three-dimensional voxelized object into this super ornamental Nintendo Rococo table. So if you look at the tables closely, you see all these computer characters. This was all done with demagnetized neodymium magnets in four different colors. You see a little bit of the close-up. We did it in three different resolutions. So the first was a 10 millimeter voxel, and then a 5 millimeter voxel, and later a 3 millimeter voxel. And here you see a bit of a close-up of what that looks like. So the 10 millimeter voxel table was very much sort of an abstract, stylized table, and it became more realistic every step in the higher resolution. Much later, actually, I'm sort of jumping in time. We do a lot of different things that don't really use digital fabrication, but I chose the projects that have to do with digital fabrication. We started to work with robotic 3D printing, first of all with thermoplastics, and later with a two-component thermoharder material. I'll just first show the video. What you actually see is a robot pouring out a two-component material out of a nozzle that mixes it together, that hardens so quickly that you could print without the use of support structure. One of the issues with 3D printing is, very much the limitation in size, but also the amount of support structure that everybody needs to use in order for your object not to collapse during printing. And using a material like this sort of eliminates the need for support structure. So we could basically print horizontally from the wall or upside down from the ceiling with the same ease. Later on also applied a CMYK color system so that you can digitally change the color of your print during printing. And again, this all looks pretty nice. It's like meditative to look at, I always think. But the material itself in the end is very brittle. So again, not that useful to make something out of that people can actually use. Let's see if I have a video of that coloring. That's pretty nice. Here you see the real-time coloring going from green to blue. The two things on the side of the nozzle are actually heat guns that speed up the process. The whole process is a bit sped up, by the way, so that it's not like a real time. I think it we print about a meter per minute. Now, because of the material properties were not ideal to make functional things, we started to look into doing the same with a metal printer. That's basically a robot, an advanced welding machine that is controlled by software that we developed. And this is the first video that was done like 2 years ago. This is a time lapse of a welding nozzle printing dots of metal on top of each other. And we figured out this could also be done without the use of support structure because of the strength of the material itself. This is very much the way we like to work, actually. So there's not a lot, a gigantic amount of thinking behind it. It's just basically buying a welding machine and a robot and just trying out if the stuff works. And if it doesn't work, change the process until it works. Eventually, it ended up into something that is pretty smart and a serious company that is now working for in collaboration with many different types of industries, from architecture firms to companies that make propellers for boats and stuff. Actually, the patent of this is very old. It's not done with robots, but it is a patent from like 1928, I think. Where somebody describes here the process of putting layers of metal on top of each other to create a 3D object. The first thing we made with it is called Dragon Bench. It is basically a matrix of metal wires that are linked around the surface. Afterwards, we developed the process a bit further. Dot welding is one way of doing things. Another way of doing things is, of course, linear a way of working. With linear printing, we have linear printing is sort of useful, but not if you like to print horizontally. It's a long story and a bit of a technical thing to go into right now. Printing dots, though, allows to print crazy difficult objects from any angle. So that's very promising. So you could say we have three types of printing. One is printing matrices of lines or lattices, if you like, surfaces and dots, and surfaces that are linearly print. As an illustration of how big we can go, I wanted to do a bronze sculptural object that is also exhibited in the show. This is an example of how far we can go with linear printing. It is very challenging to do something like this at this size, primarily because of the overhang of the specific waves of the object, of the specific cells, and also because of the shrinkage because of the internal tension in the material. There's a video showing what the process looks like. One of the biggest challenges is to overcome these internal tension issues. So we're creating this type of feedback loop from sensors that know the quality of the print, that analyzes how off the object is actually from the CAD file that we are using. And so the robot is able to change strategy so that the object still is printable. This first piece, I think, took us about 4 weeks to create, but there was a lot of manual labor needed. Right now, we could do it probably in say 2 weeks or so. We can put down about three kilos an hour of that stuff. It still looks highly oxidized, by the way. And also the oxidization process is not really helpful for the printing. But all these issues are to be overcome in the near future. I'm creating eight new types of sculptural screens in different geometries to illustrate what all is possible with this. So at a certain point in time, about 2 years ago, we figured, heck, why don't we just make something crazy with it? We came with the idea to print a bridge. A very stupid idea to think, let's do a bridge, because it's like a crazy complex project. Most of all, because of the issues we have with making it safe, of course. 3D printing always has problems with the material. You always have weak links in your print, and you want to know everything about your material so you can analyze if it's safe or not. We are working really hard to get this process certified so that things are safe. One of the things that we are creating, for instance, is this data log where you can go back in history of your print and see exactly where your print is of high quality and where it is of bad quality, so you can either repair it or redo it. The idea of this project is to also have the robots print their own support structure so that they start from one side of the water and go over the water until the bridge is finished. Highly challenging as well. But we work together with some really great partners that help us out with a lot of these technical issues, like location of the robots on the bridge with an accuracy of a millimeter. That's pretty hard in something large as this. The bridge will have a span about 8 meters. We are at the moment printing it. By the beginning of April, we will have the first 2 meters of the bridge printed. here you see different stages in the process where or the starting point of the design was a topology optimization process, which in the end was not so helpful because the location of where the bridge is going is one of the oldest canals in Amsterdam, and hardly anyone, including the city of Amsterdam, doesn't know anything about the canal walls, which is quite handy to know if you make something that is super heavy and needs to bear a lot of people. So we changed the design concept into a different concept later on. Here you see we scanned the location in Amsterdam. We needed to have very accurate dimensions of the situation. And on top of that, we started to generate this design that was first of all started off using tubes that was based on a first topology optimization analysis. But there is a lot of problems with using a truss structure like this. So we evolved into something and using a type of a U profile like sheet method where you could say analyze the stresses that go in go into the sheet and use that as the input for your design. So this is eventually what the bridge is going to look like. The input you see on the left, you see that the sides of where the bridge ends is not really aligned. So we created this S-curve top view, and that is sort of the basis for that asymmetric design. So here you see this arch, the tube-like arch is already stopping before where the canal wall starts. So the forces are sort of transported through the bridge deck, which creates sort of a unique, nice design. This is a little sample that we've printed that illustrates the part of the bridge handrail. So the timeline of this project is about a year still. We hope to have the bridge finished by the end of this year and install it in the beginning of 2018. That's my story.
You define yourself as a designer, and of course you are, but from a very pragmatic approach of materiality, design shapes, at the end your work is embedded with a lot of technology, a lot of computation, and came as the age of the research equivalent to others and more, because you transfer your work at the real architectural scale, working with materials. Printing metals is surely the most difficult thing. I have the same question, but in two directions. As a designer, what could be for you 3D printed of other ID to produce design, a production in serie in industry? You know, is it possible? And the second thing is about the bridge. What will be for you the evolution of your research in terms of scale to go further in terms of size and scale?
Okay, so first of all, your last question. With this, we can go really far until it doesn't make sense anymore. So we have a limitation. Again, where it doesn't make sense anymore. So for instance, for propellers for ships, it's something we are investigating at the moment. We can go until like 2.50 meters or something, and bigger, it doesn't make sense anymore.
Printed,
yes, in bronze. But we are also now starting up collaborations with architecture firms, pretty big ones also, because you can imagine for printing architectural nodes, this is quite exciting. If we can get the certification process in order, and this is just basically a matter of time. So yeah, it takes time, but we can.
You mean a printed steel structure for architecture?
Yeah, yeah. That will be then built up out of standardized parts and complex nodes. You should imagine that everything that is unique and fairly large scale, made in weldable metal, it's very abstract. That's where we are good at, and can compete with other types of industry. Like we could never compete with some form of industry that makes repetitive, like H beams, for instance, or you know, those type of objects. But when things become complex in geometry and unique, and you need a lot of them, all different, then it makes a lot of sense to make it this way.
It means that it's possible to work with engineer immediately to about resistance, those kind of structures?
Yeah, yeah. Well, for the bridge, we work with a lot of partners. Eh? Like Arup is involved in the process, and Autodesk and ArcelorMittal, and like a lot of big industries. So also what's kind of helpful to explain, I'm not the person that is doing the business side of that company. We've set up a whole new company called MX3D around that. I still have my design practice, and I actually use the company to create the things that I like to make. So I'm involved in the company as an owner and founder, but not as as an active manager or something like that. So what was your first question?
First question is about the possible production in serie.
Yeah, so I think, it doesn't make a lot of sense, again, to compete with people that do serial production. It does make sense to create, like if you have to do, I'm just thinking into the future, if you have to do an airport terminal with a surface that has 10,000 different nodes that are different each time, it could make a lot of sense to do it like this instead of casting it and grinding, et cetera, et cetera. It's something we are sort of investigating, but yeah.
We're waiting for this next step, of course. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Maintenant, Philippe Morel. Donc, Philippe Morel,
so now we listen to Philippe Morel. Philippe Morel is the architect with whom I used to work for
the design of l'architecture non-standard.
The non-standard architecture space.
He had developed the first
chairs with voxel distribution made out of wood. And then he decided also to specialize in work of printed concrete. And now he's got his own company, XtreeE. And
just for the case of printed metal,
so we also go wider scale with resistance calculation for this mass production of concrete.
Ok. Bonsoir. Tout d'abord, je vous remercie pour
Good evening. First of all, thank you. Thank you very much, Daniel Mierou, Marie-Ange, Olivier Détou, for inviting me and the organization of this wonderful exhibition. And so now I'm going to speak about 3D printing and also about architecture and. We need to also present some of the works we did with Cci-Centre Architecture, Philippe Sagi and myself, and also XtreeE, which is the company we've just been talking about. Well, first of all, I would like to ask a question. Is there a logic in 3D printing? That is where the feeling is that when we look at what's happening today, then there are technologies which are deterministic, that is, they have such a power, such internal power and such a logic that we cannot avoid transformation they can bring to the society. In the wider meaning of the term, when we look at the landscape, I mean, that's what we can see. And when I refer to this logic in 3D printing, then, of course, I mean, I remember what happened at the beginning of a century. I mean, all the debates around logical construction of the world, Carnac, 1928. But with digital now, it seems that we have come into a replication of the world because we have the possibility of replicating everything which surrounds us. One aspect I've always been interested in around this logic is, and which explains also the reason why, after all, I mean, I've always been less interested in sculpture than painting, because painting has a different dimension, more abstract dimension, whereas for art or for architects, and many architects, I mean, this is the medium, the which is as close as possible to their discipline. And this kind of universality character, the link existing with the language, using the digital aspect, this link, this universal data on which many architects thought about. Boulle, Turing, for example, I mean, this kind of reflection is very interesting in terms of conception and design. Another aspect is also the evolution of our communication media. If you think of Mario Carpo, spoke about printing, and here we can see, we can read this quotation by Victor Hugo, where it's a kind of a deterministic manifesto, actually, or rather manifesto about determinism, where Victor Hugo ends up saying that the great building, I mean, the great work of humanity will not be built anymore, it will be printed. And when he thinks about printing, I mean, he thinks about printing in the real meaning of the term. And now what about printing? Does the printing give the architecture the power, the expression power, and the flexibility which is linked to the printing aspect? So the question about the replication is very important. Now we can see in this exhibition a picture of an artist I've always very much appreciated, Mel Buckner. And this exhibition was held in 1966 in New York at the School of Virtual Art. And this exhibition by Mel Buckner, where for the first time he would use a copying machine, and we had four times the same work being reproduced. And something I found interesting also when is about the dialectic existing between the abstract question about language, the concept, discretization of space, and the continuity of various things. And this deterministic aspect is repeated in the great invention in the 20th century, transistor, for example, and printed circuit. Of course, I mean, maybe we could say that these are the main, most important invention in the 20th century. I mean, if we would say this to people, they would just wonder about what we're saying. But the conceptual element is the most important in terms of the fundamental for the existence of the TV and all the following technologies. And this is what happened also with the 3D printing. For example, it was revolutionary with the quotes. Now today, I mean, we would remove the quotes, and it's clear that we're really convinced that it was revolutionary. And the same thing with the computer and the 3D invention being a kind of an American invention and French invention. And this is something which has already been mentioned. I mean, of course, this technology allows many things. We can be suspicious in a way, saying that it allows to do everything. So in several cases, I mean, we run the risk of being disappointed, saying that 3D printing allows everything. Now, apart from this very short introduction, I would like to come back to a quote in architecture in 1990s when the 3D printing appeared. We are in a situation where we are leaving modernism and we start reflecting, we were reflecting about a demographic growth, real world reorganization, the very first experiments, wondering about the use of computers for urbanization with various architects, a genius, an academic genius in terms of architectural composition, but he will be the pioneer in Cci-Centre Associate Center. Those who yet Cci-Centre had the 30th biggest computer available in the world, and so it's like an architect office having 3D printing as powerful as a big bank or various social networks. So this vision of the city will lead in the 90s to Jam Kola's approaches, talking about the data aspects. And this vision of the generic aspects, we can consider where we may think about something generic, versatile, universal in terms of computation. And then we go back to previous works, going back to 1960, Peter Eisenman, where we try to restore a kind of rationalism, a kind of this rationalism which is going to fail as the purist architecture, Le Corbusier, failed also. And also in the 60s, there were these postmodernism, New York Five, Frédéric also quoted in his introduction. I mean, we're going to start understanding that we're going to distort the language of modern architecture, and to repeat Greg Lynn terms, we're going to see that we are sort of topologies are groovy, and we are going to start understanding that something is happening. So this distortion we can see in this picture, and we expand the Villa Savoie, we'll open the door to postmodernism and postmodern architecture with a new modern architectural language. And on a political, at a political level, then we're going to understand also things we are already familiar with in the world of architecture, but not that much well known outside architecture. That is a kind of liquefaction and a fiasco, because we're moving from a hard world, rigid world, to this kind of flexible world, kind of liquefied world, to repeat the terms of Bronzi, with this picture, 1969, structure in liquefaction. However, in 1990s, the kind of mechanist vision of the world, with Dylan's Coffee Dew, for example, with a kind of vision going back to Cartesianism, using the machine, which on a different stage with Aldous, referring to various modern compositions from genre, which you can see on the slide, a kind of comeback to nostalgia to this age where we're using machines. We usually pen time to criticize, actually. With we have this project, Neil Denari, from the Tokyo International Forum, exhibited there. And then the very last recent machine, typing machine, Olivetti typing machine, which led Olivetti in a kind of bankruptcy, because Olivetti didn't get the message regarding the power of the digital aspect. So it was a kind of a big dinosaur, always being out of order, impossible to repair. And so then the first computers were very big machines, and we could think that it would be the same thing. But we had, in terms of epistemology, we moved from the analog model to the digital time, and we used to speak about mechanization having the power, whereas the situation changed. And it was quite surprising to see two books very important with their different disciplines published in the same year. At the beginning of the 90s, folding in architecture, this was this book was re-edited in 2005. The first edition was in 1995. Now, some architects, Greg Lynn, who was the publisher of this book, Bernard Cash also, are getting interested in the digital aspect in a different angle. I mean, each of them having a different angle. Bernard Cash, looking at architecture in terms of production machines with a kind of a Marxist vision. It tries to reconnect the production to architecture. And also, well, without really paying attention to the difference you can see on the right slide with these epistemological differences between analog and digital, discrete and continuous. The Barakas aesthetism is the aesthetism of continuity, and he's never been interested in questioning this aspect. Greg Lynn, I'm not going to read the whole paragraph, but Greg Lynn, we can see at the bottom of the slide, is going to introduce some complex, complicated appliant foldings, also thinking about the Gilles Deleuze foldings, waving, joining also. I mean, things which were mentioned previously, that is, try to restore a kind of complexity in the continuity, which is not a complexity of collapse. And he says himself, I mean, he means the collage complexity, but post-modernity, Robert Venturi-like, which opens the way to a reflection on complexity of the digital, because the digital is in a kind of logical continuum and not at all in a kind of modernist collage approach. Some concepts, that is, standardization, we'll see later, will reappear in the exhibition at the Centre Pompidou, are going to appear. I mean, Marshall McLuhan was the first to speak about this concept in 1969 in a book called Mutation, 1990, where he identified the time when his production, his non-standard production, would appear in the society, saying that when electronic machines will be fully developed, then it will be as simple as to get a million of different objects rather than copying them a million times. So this is what we have today. On the web, it's very easy to look at this, but when we come to producing things, it's a different business. Now, we're talking about Lars Spiebruck, Cash, Apollo, Casse Osterhuis with the programmable architecture, and some other people who are going to get hold of this notion of digital. Now, the exhibition is going to gather this generation And we were lucky, as Frédéric mentioned it, with Félix and Yella, we were lucky to take part directly to this exhibition using Mathematica, as it was mentioned, to generate this pattern, which is, well, something which wouldn't have been possible to generate with another system, because the accuracy level which was needed to have such a motive with that scale was inaccessible, and we tested it, actually. So it was really difficult with a standard architecture software. But at that time, we just were just happy with this kind of motive, because we couldn't build up a 3D project on such a great surface area. This notion of continuity, then, Greg Lynn found it with Larcy Thompson in 1917, and this vision of Larcy Thompson was rather in the air, actually. It was something we could see in the Granville pictures, this quoting from Emerson, each creator is only a modification of the other. So we really had this feeling of a kind of continuity evolution between things, and on a more mathematical way. At the same time, we didn't have this automaton. We had this various concept, a differential equation. And so this differential equation, the differential calculation, was something very present in the 70s with Greg Lynn, as you can see on the right-hand side, and then the aesthetics by Juliette and Marais on the left. And we can see that on a more visual aspect, I mean, we have these differences between the pictures by Pierre Bézier, the geometric continuity, and then the mathematical surfaces from the end of the 19th century. And so, of course, I mean, we're entering a kind of plenty of shapes. But here we had a limited set of shapes with craftsmanship. But now with the digital, we grant shape to potential infinity. And personally speaking, despite the progress this represented, then the link between the digital data, logic, and geometry was missing, because looking at these curves, not really spline, but subdivision curves, though it is mathematically demonstrated that they are equivalent, but still, it is something which is discrete, but it is something very complex to reach continuity. Now, this link, I think it was... and in fact, Gilles Manuel showed it. I mean, you can see this dialectic between the discrete and continuous, because today we conceive with a voxelization, we have formal approaches. And when we manufacture, then we do not necessarily have a kind of accurate translation from term to term between what is physical and what is abstract. And so these concepts, which were developed by Cournot, the limits, the correspondence between algebra and geometry, the concept of computation and geometry evoked by Pernod. This is something which I've already found very interesting. Now, this question came back with Wolfram, who developed SMP. Now, before Mathematica, there was SMP. A symbolic manipulation program developed by Chris Cole and Stephen Wolfram in 1981 in Caltech. And this was a kind of new breathing because new impetus, because it was interesting to see the richness of the design programs. But at the end, I mean, we're using icons, we use geometric functionalities. We don't really know what they represent and what is really hiding behind. We can see what they do. It's clear. I mean, we just don't know how they operate. And whereas if we open Mathematica, this is what we get, I mean, a blank page. And so we really had the feeling that we would start from scratch in terms of concept. So having the feeling of working like the architect did regarding mechanism or postmodernism or deconstructivism. So my feeling was that I needed to have this kind of way of going a different path. Then we mentioned, we went through Cedric Price or John Fraser later, but with a less scientist aspect. So trying to come back to the very nature of information, trying to understand what this represented, also trying to understand all the social interferences. I was a student when the SML came out, and the Bernard Cash works, Regling works. I started trying to find a kind of synthesis of all this. We know today that digital and digital technologies are boundless and are without boundaries, and it's a total turmoil of the whole social field. And so it was also a way to me to go further in a kind of understanding the social consequences and economic consequences of the things, not only on a formal way, but this is a curriculum vitae that was an ad for the for Ruben. Now, in this advertisement, it was a fake CV. I mean, what is interesting, he doesn't ask for any increase and for any. He's never ill, and when he's ill, I mean, he just asks to be repaired. So we have this general effect of computer on the business world which surrounds us. And this was something which to me seemed of paramount importance and seemed prevailing. I'm not really interested in planning, but in town planning, but still, I mean, some of my colleagues are do things which have consequences on town planning. Now, this computer was essential to me. It's similar to what we see in the finance business, where the world is so small. I mean, we start with nanoseconds, and we reach the big scale. And we think of Charles Sims with global consequences. That is, we try to reach the best trading, high frequency trading, and we reach the whole world, similar to Charles Graham. The data aspect also was lacking in the 90s. The digital simulation also generating a high quantity of data with a complete change of perspective, concept also. With an evolution which goes beyond the field of architecture. Now, Raymond Abraham on the left-hand side, Philippe Jensen, Archigram, and also an ad for Samsung. Pierre Cutelli works. a kind of a fetishism which gives birth to a kind of a culturist philosophy, permanent culturist philosophy with the kind of situation we have. That is something which goes beyond the style. We go out of rationalism, which is still difficult to turn into a theory. In a more practical way, the works which led us to what is shown here is based on the interest we had on discrete. I mean, we spoke a lot about chairs. Now, this is a project going back to 2004, so it goes back 12 years ago. And we worked on the algorithmic generation, producing chairs. And there's one model, among others, which was presented at Art Basel in 2007. And then the iconic model, the one which many of us prefers. And then the interaction also on the way we can build up such a thing. I mean, it's because, OK, we have this model, fair enough. But how do we build up? How do we build up these elements? When we look at the voxelized approach, then we are not in the field of continuity anymore. I mean, there are continuities, but they are sort of a neighbor continuity, kind of neighboring continuity. We are not really in the cellular automaton, but we are in a kind of parallel logic in a kind of digital geometry. Digital geometry, in the strict meaning of a term, is what we try to study here. That is a kind of geometry which doesn't, which works with full numbers. And so when we work with full numbers only, it's rather interesting because we control all the dimension. We do not have any problems in terms of translation from the digital to manufacturing, because the only thing we're going to look at is the kind of the relation and the architectural aspect. I mean, loses its character. We do not need to translate geometric curves into a file describing the various points of the geometric curves. And we don't need this anymore. I mean, you just have matrices, relation matrices. So in terms of concept, this was quite rather interesting, and which gave birth to this project from the Universal House, which is a kind of constructive system which would be able to do everything with auto self-blocking elements, which is working quite properly. But however, I mean, we wondered when once we have these elements, how do we rigidify them? And it was it was why we got interested in concrete. I mean, the 3D printing process finds its origin actually in a kind of reflection on discrete and on the way we move to a larger scale, a kind of reflection on scaling of discretization. And this is really something which was presented at the Creative University in 2012, 4 years ago. So it was really modest, the first steps. You can see here pieces in brass. And but I mean, it was so complicated. I mean, I think we left things aside because there were some technical and conceptual issues we couldn't solve. But at least, I mean, we were reconnected to architecture in a way. Architecture in the wider meaning of the term, in all its dimension, including the historical background of construction. That's the Peter Eisenmann's brother in front of the Pantheon, and then the reflection also carried out on the problematic of wires and lightness, and how do we address all this, and how do we do to produce what we have on the left, avoiding any failing, any failure. Working with these mesh and lattices, and with various projects you could see on the slide. Another project, I mean, we wonder what this is. I mean, this is concrete, high performance concrete cast in a sand mold, the same used angle as here. And also this work on the on the molds. And we can see that even when we optimize the manufacturing aspects, we are clashing against scale limits. Using sand molds, the advantage is that we can give any appearance. We have the appearance of knots, but these are all just concrete artifacts being cast into sand molds. So we saw how difficult it was to change scale using the sand technique. And so we carried on the work with Frédéric at that time, Auciel, and with cellular automaton with a 3D printing, which allows us to do some experiments. I mean, these are students' work, wonderful students' work, actually. And also techniques like collage in clay mold with Gramley from the Greenstein farm, and also university project, Democrite. And out of all this, with the historical background, with all the students, I had the opportunity to train at the University of Paris Malaquais and private investors with XtreeE also. We all worked together and we managed to produce a 3D printing at architectural scale. And so here we can see some parts which was produced, kind of small sculpture for as I did, which was produced a month ago, a month and a half ago, maybe in our workshop, production workshop, with a big robot, a small pavilion, commissioned and ordered by Région Île-de-France and Dassault system, weighing, well, 17 tons. Which was delivered, and which was delivered by crane, and then Aix-en-Provence, another project, without really knowing how we're going to proceed, and manufacturer was saying that we're going to use the technique I showed you with the sand mold, and so finally, I mean, in between, I mean, the company was created. You can see Magdalie Bar. I mean, you can see. And with this project, which was carried out, and of course, I mean, it's kind of modest project with a 4-meter column with a context of small accommodation and building systems, with a small budget also. But still, I mean, it was a premiere. It was the first time that we would build up this kind of column in 3D with concrete collage, with ultra-performing concrete. And also, what you see on the top, and I will conclude in three slides, I will show you a small video. Now, the resolution degree in 3D printing is quite interesting, with a lot of challenges to be met regarding the support, the material, the last version of tools developed by XtreeE in terms of industrial toughness. It's like having a pen here, printing the object, and then an example of a constructive knot, which is presented here. Thank you very much for your attention. We have we don't have much time, so I would like to ask the architects to join me to the podium, please. Jenny. Jenny, Jill, and the others also, to answer the questions from the audience. I find it difficult to see how we feed 3D machines. I mean, are you talking about plastic? But for example, aluminium, I mean, what do you use for aluminium? I mean, how do you feed the 3D printing, actually? I'm a kind of lay person. I mean, I'm not very acquainted with the techniques. The question is about how, what do you use? I mean, when you do produce 3D printing, I mean, what do you use when you produce 3D printing plastic? And when it's aluminium, what do you use, powder aluminium, or how would you proceed? I mean, using a 3D printer, what is the material you use?
I'm not quite sure what the question is. I think you mean the ground material, the beginning material. It differs with every technique. So when you
Ah, je vous parlais des différentes techniques. Alors, nous, on imprime avec un fer à souder d'une certaine manière. Donc,
wire rod that
on a donc un fil, on a une buzette, et puis alors la buzette qui fait fondre le matériau. Et lorsqu'on imprime de l'aluminium, par exemple, c'est la technique que l'on utilise, SLM, où on utilise un lit de poudre en fusion, et puis qui permet d'associer les particules et d'imprimer. L'impression en plastique, c'est complètement différent. On peut commencer avec un système de thermodurcisseur que l'on utilise pour pouvoir imprimer la matière avec différents composants de liquide que l'on mélange pour durcir la préparation en thermoplastique. On démarre aussi avec un fil à souder, etc., etc. Mais je ne sais pas si c'est votre question. Est-ce que ça répond à votre question? What about metal or brass or whatever? What do you use? I mean, to print.
Pour le béton.
And for concrete as well. For concrete, we start with concrete. Raw material, molten with water to create the hydraulic reaction, because concrete. Means a kind of a chemical transformation, and then we manage to reach the right texture at the end, so that the concrete is enough fluid to be extruded and sufficiently structured so that it would resist. One of the great difficulty for concrete printing is the different layer which are going to be built, and the time to move from one layer to another, because depending on the time it takes to print the layer and the geometry of the piece, then for one piece we're going to have an awful lot of characteristic and mechanic features which are completely different between the various layers. And so in terms of construction, in terms of standardization of the construction process, it is something which is rather negative. So this is part of the challenges we have to meet at the moment when building with concrete. And another question also from the audience.
Hello, thank you. Merci. I have a question for you, Jenny, Sabin. I was quite interested in your, let's say, DNA project. And I was wondering, let's say, what kind of speculation or what kind of concept you think that could be interesting in data-driven design with DNA, with biological or even microorganisms embedded in matter, either in architectural scale or any scale, let's say, design scale.
Yeah, I should mention that the work with Dan with the DNA steering within clay is quite new, within the last 6 to 8 months. But we're quite excited about it because of its simplicity. The clay as matter is a really productive matrix for seeding the DNA. And we literally are working with DNA you can get off the internet sometimes. Most of the DNA that Dan brings into his lab is ordered off the internet, frequently spinach DNA. but lately we've been working with synthetic human DNA as a way of steering. But the one thing that we're working on right now is just how it operates as a glaze and what we can do in terms of navigating the processes of ceramics and firing. And so we're in the process of firing some of the initial prototypes and samples just to simply steer a kind of set of dynamic surface techniques to begin with. The promise of then moving into self-assembly and bricks that self-assemble, I think we have some ways to go. So we're working with it at a superficial level at this point in terms of surface applications.
Somebody asked me to ask a last question. I'm sorry. Oh, no, the last will be you.
Une question vraiment prosaïque pour l'architecture.
Prosaic questions regarding the architecture of tomorrow.
On va construire avec des imprimantes 3D.
So we will start building
houses,
so 3, 4, 5 floors with 3D printing. So when could it start, actually? I won't be the only one to answer the question, by the way. Well, I'm personally convinced that a 3 to 4 story building could be built before 10 years. So between now and 10 years, I would say. But anyways, if you look at the evolution of building at large, so the beginning of concrete, so you know, the beginning, so you had small pots for trees, for instance, it was nothing. People couldn't use concrete, and then after a certain number of years, after a few decades, actually people began to think of it seriously and started to build buildings. It took 25 years actually before we really started making use of that system, and now so we've got 1,000 meter high buildings and we've got 2 kilometer long bridges. So personally, I think there's no limit for 3D printing. So what about you?
I think 10 years, there's already a company in China which, with a combination of 3D printing concrete and casting concrete, has already done a two-story house. So I mean, in that sense, I also think it's important to be optimistic and to kind of keep that as a possible future. Like, I don't think we have to be too careful and say, like, you know, this will take 30 years. Let's put 5 to 10 years and be optimistic and try to really accelerate this process.
Okay.